Well, friends, we're beginning our recording now, and again, it's great to be able to be here with you and celebrate this this wonderful time of joint Bible study. And I'm going to share our screen as we've done before. For those of you on the phone, we'll continue to try to describe everything that's on the screen so you won't have to miss out. But we're looking this evening at James chapter 1, and we are talking about listening and doing, or hearing and doing. And I have a real quick, somewhat rhetorical question. There's 37 of us on the line, so we can't really answer this question, but I do want to just ask this question. Has anyone here ever learned to master any skill just by listening to someone teach it? If you have done that in some incredible way, then you are an awesome person. I don't know of anybody who has learned to swim by listening somebody teach it. I don't know anybody who's learned to ride a bicycle by listening just to somebody teach it. And so James is going to challenge us to not only hear, but to put into practice so that we can master this walk in our Christian faith. So we're looking this evening at James chapter 1. Beginning at verse 19, and we'll be reading from the NRSV, that's the New Revised Standard Version.
Verse 19, you must understand this, my beloved. Let everyone be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to anger. Verse 20, for your anger does not produce God's righteousness. Verse 21, therefore, rid yourselves of all sordidness and rank growth of wickedness, and welcome with meekness the implanted word that has the power to save your soul. But be doers of the word, and not merely hearers who deceive themselves. Verse 23, for if any are hearers of the word and not doers, they are like those who look at themselves in a mirror. Verse 24, for they look at themselves and on going away immediately forget what they were like. Verse 25, but those who look into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and persevere, being not hearers who forget, but doers who act, they will be blessed in their doing. Verse 26, if any think they are religious and do not bridle their tongues, but deceive their hearts, their religion is worthless. Verse 27, religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this, to care for orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself unstained by the world.
Amen. The word of God for the people of God.
Amen.
Be to God.
God.
Again, let's get a little background information about our author and what's going on with the text. So James is written by the younger brother of Jesus. We find evidence for that in a couple of scriptures in the Bible. There are some Bible scholars that somewhat dispute that, but overwhelmingly, most people attribute the authorship of this book to James, the younger brother of Jesus. It's one of the earliest books ever written in the New Testament. It was written about 40 to 50 AD. James was one of the pastors in the Jerusalem church. It's a short book. It only has five chapters, and some have even called it the Proverbs of the New Testament. It gets that name because it has several little quick and pithy sayings, but just carry a lot of weight and a lot of impact. Now, the driving theme behind the book of James is faith in action. Now, you don't have to unmute. You can say it right there in your own space, but I want everybody to repeat after me. Faith.
Faith in action.
Amen. Yes. Now, ironically, he starts by saying that one action of faith is the action of patience. We tend to think about patience as sitting around twiddling our thumbs or waiting in a long, drawn-out way, but that's not the way the Bible describes it. Remember, we said last week that God is doing something in this process, that God is revealing stuff to me in this process. When you have consciously decided, when you have consciously made a decision to be patient, you have chosen a course of action. Instead of choosing a course of action that says, I'm going to hurry through this, or I'm going to rush and get it over with, instead you say, no, I'm going to bear under it. I'm going to endure under it. So get this, watch this, friends. Right off the bat, boom, in chapter 1, James says, put your faith in action as you endure the pressures of life. Put your faith in action as you encounter the temptations of life. Chapter 2, put your faith in action as you show equal treatment to everyone. He's going to start talking about favoritism. He's going to start talking about discrimination. But the way you show your faith in action is through equal treatment. Chapter 3, put your faith in action by getting control of your tongue. Ooh-wee! That's a word for all of us. That's a word for all of us. To put your faith in action by getting control of your tongue. Chapter 4, put your faith in action by submitting to the Lord. Chapter 5, put your faith in action as you pray for one another. So now that we're all on board and everybody knows exactly what we're going to be talking about, we're going to be doing this from now through the end of May. We have decided that we're going to stay in the book of James, and we're going to cover as many of these topics as we can. We're just going to go line by line, verse by verse, as many as we can, and this will be what will carry our Bible study for the rest of April and all the way through May. I hope that works for everybody. Amen. So we're going to be talking about faith in action. Let me go back. I'll read verse 19, and then we're going to get our first principle. So again, verse 19 says, you must understand this, my beloved. Let everyone be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to anger, for your anger does not produce God's righteousness. And so our first biblical application, the first note that you can write down, for those of you who want to take notes, you can say this: faith in action means listening and speaking without anger.
Amen. Amen. One of the reasons why it is listening and speaking without anger is because the word that comes to us to be quick to listen and to slow to speak is literally working it out on behalf of someone else. Most of us really approach life and our ways and everything we do from a kind of a self-centered perspective. We are going to self-preserve. We're going to think of what's good for us. We're going to think about what we want, what's working for us. And we approach situations in that way. When I think about the two of us here at the house together, sometimes I'm not thinking about what's best for him. I'm thinking about what do I need? What do I need to get done? How do I handle this? And so faith in action means that I have to consider his needs or the kids' needs or somebody else's needs before my own. And so quick to listen is thinking about somebody else. Being slow to speak is thinking about somebody else. It is working on behalf of somebody else. Now, why are we encouraged to be slow to anger or slow to wrath in some of your other translation? Is because our wrath or our anger isn't godly or righteous at all. Previously in the scriptures ahead of where we are, we were encouraged to consider being tempted and tested as a means of seeing where we are in God's will. And we know if we're being tested by God or we're in situations where we're being tempted by Satan or something, it's not a good feeling at all. And a lot of times when we're in those situations, like when we were out there and we were trying to get to work on time and somebody cut us off, and so we had a moment of, are we going to be godly or are we going to be ourselves? If we were in ourselves, that's not righteousness right there. We're not going to give them the word of God. We're going to give them ourselves. And sometimes our anger and our wrath is not sometimes, it's not godly, which is why we have to be very slow to get there, slow to do the things that we may need, but end up causing that feeling of anger up in us. So we're called to be slow into that. Another confession, I know in our married life, sometimes I'm trying to wonder which is the harder test for me. Yeah, I know he didn't know I was going to say this. To admit that I'm wrong or to wait for him to admit that he was wrong in something. And I mean, that has been a hard lesson for me. And when I get to that place, whatever is going on, the situation, we're stuck. We are stuck together because I won't let go. I won't let things move. And I'm sitting up there waiting up for myself or waiting for him. That is not godly at all. In that whole season, it's not, I need to listen and hear where he's coming from. He needs to listen and see where I'm coming from so that we can move past. Yeah, so that we can move past whatever issue. I said it was a learning. I'm still learning on that one. But anyway, we are called to be slow into that so that we don't get stuck in a season of just an ickiness in our relationships. We are called to be faithful to God so that we're not stuck in our mess. Amen? Amen. Any other comments?
Listen, I'll add to this also, you know, this is not a command to never feel anger, right?
Right.
Anger is a human emotion, and it can even at times be justified. So this is not a command not to feel anger. However, James is making it clear that we can learn to control or at least slow down our angry responses. And also, we don't want to forget the context into which James is writing. Remember, I'm real big about making sure we understand the context. James is writing to people who are under persecution. He's writing to believers whose lives are under pressure. So we started with that thought last week. And as we're carrying it forward, you know, one of the times that we're the times and the places where we're most likely to pop off is when we're under pressure, right? When we're calm and everything is cool and all good, we're not likely to let our tongues go with crazy and you know, and say some stupid stuff. But whenever we are starting to feel pressure, when we're starting to feel the heat of the moment, that's whenever when we're more likely to make a mistake and it's harder to hold our tongue. And so James, in writing to that context, reminds us, listen, yeah, you can feel anger. Anger is a human emotion. But if you really want to put your faith in action, it means listening and speaking with anger and control or without anger. And so that's definitely a growing point. We just said we don't get this just because some preacher stood up and told us, or we read it for ourselves one time in the Bible. This is something you've got to put into practice, and you've got to do over and over and over again. And you might ride your bike and fall over and skin up your knees, but you got to get back up and try again. So faith in action means listening and speaking without anger. Well, one other thing I was going to say, I think it was Dr. Freddie Haynes, although I don't have the, I couldn't find the exact citation, but I saw this and I just thought it was pretty powerful. But doubting that God is in control speeds up our mouth and slows down our mind. I just thought that was powerful. Yeah. Doubting that God is in control speeds up our mouth and slows down our mind. All right, let's look at the next verse. Verse 21. Therefore, rid yourselves of all sordidness and rank growth of wickedness, and welcome with meekness the implanted word that has the power to save your souls. And so we drew an application point from that, being that faith in action means releasing evil and accepting the word.
Amen. And another way of saying releasing that evil, some of our texts say laying aside all the evil in our lives. We just have to lay it aside. The first question that I want to throw at it is, why don't we really want to do that? I mean, it's in the word for us to do, but why don't we really want to do that? Any takers? Why don't we really want to lay it aside?
A lot of time people want to have something to hold on to.
That's right. That's right. Sometimes the evil that is around us, it feels good to us. It might be evil and ugly and unhealthy, but it feels good in our lives. What about some other things?
Well, sometimes
we let pride get in the way.
That's right. Go ahead, Mr. Ken.
I think we were saying the same thing. The other answer was pride, and it's because we think we're right.
That's right. Sometimes our family and friends are attached to it. And we know to let go of certain behaviors means that we can no longer be around certain family and friends. Sometimes it's ingrained in us. Sometimes I have met people along the journey that have been ingrained, reared in just unsavory behaviors, to where they didn't even know that it was unsavory behavior. They didn't know that other people didn't live like that, because they thought everybody lived like that. And so not only do we have to ask the question, why do we or why do others, because again, as we're pointing the fingers to other people, we have to make sure that they're coming back to us. But as we are talking about why we don't want to get rid of the evil around in our lives, we have to ask the other big question is, how do we do it? How do we stop it? How do we lay aside? How do we release the evil in our lives? Well, some of the things that we need to do to stop it is you have to watch what you watch. You have to watch what you listen to. Some of us, the evil is not necessarily hurting ourselves. I know my folks know that I had a crazy love affair with Little Debbie's. Sometimes you got to release what you're eating. Sometimes you have to think about what you're eating because it's not healthy for you. You have to watch what you touch, and you have to watch what you think about things. And so there's all kinds of stuff in and around us. When we look at how to release the evils around us or release the things or let go certain things, you have to stop how it actually gets into your life in the first place. And then once you kind of identify what those things are that you need to stop in the first place, then you've got to stop it from growing. You've got to watch the company that you keep. You have to stop whatever is feeding that thing or those people that's in your life that God is saying, this is not pleasing to me. You have to put this to rest. And then lastly, which is really huge and a lot of people don't really talk about, but I know I talk about a lot when I get in private conversations with people, is that you need to pray and ask God to terminate that desire. Because again, it's nice for you to say in your own will, I've not met too many people, myself included, who has been able to stop a bad behavior. You can want to, you can really just desire it. And some people have. It's almost like my husband lifted up how many people have mastered a skill only by listening. A lot of behaviors that are out there that are unhealthy, especially when there is a feel-good attachment desire to that, you can't stop it on your own. You literally have to go to God and ask God to pray to God, ask God to break or terminate that desire in your life. That is literally how I got delivered from Little Debbie. And I promise you, that was not an easy thing. But you have to ask God and pray to God, deliver me from whatever this feeling is or this desire that is unlike you that you are asking me to stop. Now, the other thing too, and if you've got something to say, please jump in. The other thing to consider too is, you remember back in the 80s when Nancy Reagan had the Just Say No campaign for drugs, Just Say No? I hope some of my hands are coming up and saying, yeah, I remember that. One of the downfalls to that campaign is that if you're saying no to something, you got to say yes to something else. And so the word of God comes in and says, you can say no to that thing, but say yes to the imprinting of my word that is in your heart, that is already there. And so the battle is really half won because you don't have to look for help. You don't have to seek after assistance. You don't have to wonder if your help is already there because the word of God is already implanted into your spirit. That is the second half of that scripture. And please know, the second half of that the welcome with meekness, the implanted word that has the power to save your souls. This has the power. The word of God has the power to save your souls completely. Now, again, many of us are grateful. That's where we have this, we say that the Lord is the Lord and Savior of our life. And we are so grateful that God is our Savior. It secures for us our eternal life with God. And that's a wonderful thing. But many of us are very shaky on Jesus being our Lord right here every day. And that's where that tension is, where the word of God is coming in and implanted in our hearts, that the saving of our soul is complete, but our lives are a little shaky. And so James is helping us to see how we can get our lives in line with where our soul is. And really, if you're in that kind of fit, you're not feeling good about yourself anyway, because you know what you're doing is shady and a little petty even though you might be claiming that God has redeemed my soul, you know that you're feeling some kind of way about this. And so as we know that the way that we get to receiving this is receiving God's grace and God's mercy. And we are saved because of the works of God for us, not anything that we do, but by receiving Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And as God's word is implanted in our hearts, we need to lean on that word. If we're saying no to the sins in our life and saying no to those desires and trying to release that and asking God, hey, break this desire that's in my heart, break this control that's there, now cleave to the imprinting, implanting of God's word in your heart. It's there. It's already there. It's already there. Okay.
The next portion of our text, starting at verse 22, says, but be doers of the word and not merely hearers who deceive themselves. For if any are hearers of the word and not doers, they're like those who look at themselves in a mirror. For they look at themselves and on going away, immediately forget what they were like. So James is writing, and as he's trying to encourage these people who are finding their lives under pressure, and as he's talking about not just hearing God's word, but being doers of this word, he drops in a little sermon illustration. That's always good. And so he says, you know what it's like? It's like you have taken a look at yourself in a mirror. You've seen the image that you are or you're supposed to be, and when you go away from it, you forgot who you are. And so here's the application point that we get from James on this text. Faith in action means remembering the image we display, or we could also say remembering the image that we claim. We are claiming that we are children of God. We are claiming that we are following after Christ. We are trying to be made more and more in his likeness. And if that's the case, then the actions that we do have to mirror that. We can't just say, I'm a Christian, and then go off and do something else. It's like looking in a mirror and seeing the image of who we are and walking away and forgetting who we are. I really like that. I like the way that James weaves that in there for us. Faith in action means remembering the image that we display or the image that we claim.
Amen. And sometimes not only just remembering the image, sometimes we in our real life really just gravitate towards just being hearers of the word. Those folks who really just, you know, I go to church, I love the Lord, he heard my cry. And that's as far as it goes. Or I go to church on Sunday and I go to Bible study on Wednesday, but all during the rest of the week, that belongs to me. and I'm just saying, these are things that I've heard people say in my walk and journey as a minister. People feel like as long as I'm believing the Lord, then I'm good. As long as I have faith in the Lord, then I'm good. And we need to be more than just believing Christians. We have to actually do the word that God is telling us to do. Hear what God is speaking to my life. I know my people have heard me say this over and over again. Hear what God is speaking to your life and do that. Hear what God is speaking to your heart and be faithful to that. In the name of Jesus, it literally, and you can't hear the word of God on Sunday at 11 o'clock and think you got it. It takes so much more than just Sunday 11 o'clock or Wednesday at 7 o'clock and you got it. You have got to get in that word every single day of your life. You've got to talk to God and pray to God. And the big thing is you have to listen. Because if I'm talking to him and he's not listening to me, because we get into that too were like, well, you just didn't hear what I said, then it was a mute conversation altogether. Nothing happened. And that's what happens in our faithful life when God is saying, I need for you to call somebody. I need for you to check on somebody. I need you to give that person $5. I need you to bless that person with a meal right now. I need you to look after that little kid and make sure they can read. I need you to take care of this. I need you to pay your tithes today because somebody needs that tithe money. You need to hear what God is saying to your life and be faithful to that. I use this as an illustration because I thought it was very appropriate. Dana didn't quite jive with it at first, but I'm hoping y'all will get it. Hearing what God is saying to you versus even some pastors are saying to you. So we all have heard now that there were several pastors who have asked persons during this time of social distancing to go to church. To like prove, I guess, that they're faithful or God is bigger than COVID-19. I'm not quite sure. But to their detriment, some really disastrous things have happened. And I'm of the mindset, I believe at least one of those persons that was in those services probably heard God say, you know, you don't need to be there. You know, you don't need to be at that worship service. You know that there is this diseases out there that is happening because of the contact you're having with people. Listen to what I'm saying to your heart. Even if your pastor wants to get out there and have service, let him or have service by him or herself and praise the Lord. But you don't have to be a part of that. You don't have to be there. And so even at the demise of people that we love and we have a lot of faith in, we need to hear what God is saying to our hearts, because life and death is held in what God is saying to us, not even our interpretation of it. What is God saying to you in your actions and your reactions and what God is saying in your life?
But so, that goes back to the personal relationship that you have with God.
Right.
Like you say, you can't go to church and think that you're gonna build a relationship with him or hear him there all the time. Sometimes you have to have that relationship with him so you can know what his voice sounds like for yourself. And some people may not actually have that relationship, therefore they can't decipher what God is telling them and what their pastor or what someone else is telling them to do.
I agree, but even our children, I'll say this, even our kids, when they're being taught right, they know the difference. They really do. And I'm in agreement with you, Ariel, because we all are not at the same place in our faith walk. But God moves with us in the baby food stage, and God moves with us in the table food stage. And you're exactly right. How much do you want to stop eating the baby food so you can grow in the Lord? That is up to you and growing in God. I'm going to say this one last thing, and then we're going to go move on. Hearing the word only allows you to acknowledge what is possible, but doing the word confirms with God that it was possible. Yeah. Hearing the word of God only allows you to acknowledge what is possible, and that's huge. But doing the word of God confirms that with God, it was possible. All of us are living testaments being here right now because we were here last week. Some of us are here for the first time, which is great. Some are here as a repeat. But the fact that we were here last week and now here this week, we have now become doers of that word and saw what was possible with God, because God kept us a full 7 days. Amen. We are now walking, living testimonies of what is possible with God. Amen.
Let's get down to verse 26. Verse 26 says, if any think they are religious and do not bridle their tongues, but deceive their hearts, their religion is worthless. Now, he's already touched on this a little bit before. He's definitely going to hammer it when we get to the whole taming of the tongue section. I mean, he's just going to lay it out there. we're going to really just dig into that and again, what it really means for us to bridle our tongues. But I love the fact that he's already saying, look, if you think that you got it all together as a religious person, one surefire test of that, one way that you really can know if you are walking right is what you're doing with your tongue. So if any think they're religious and do not bridle the tongues, but they deceive their hearts. Their religion is worthless. Verse 27, religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this, to care for orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself unstained by the world. And so our take-home point for this, faith in action means possessing pure religion and caring for others.
Amen. And I'm just going to use a couple of folks as an example for this as far as the bridling of the tongue, because it is so funny and I got convicted of it right and left. So Bo Peep and Minisha Govan have both gotten on me at several times by certain things that I have said. Because I have said like, oh my gosh, I'm scared. Now I'll put myself out here. The first time for Bellefonte folks that I had to do the watch night service at Oak Grove, I was petrified. Providence, it's a real big church, and when I walked in that church and it was empty the first time and saw how big it was, I got so nervous. I just sat down and was like, I can't do this. And so Minister Govan, I believe it was even in service, was like, what did you say? I know you just didn't say that. And so again, and I praise God because both people have got me on that too. I am a strong believer in embracing your humanity. I really am. Confess and call it out. If you're scared, you're scared. Be that way. However, because that's what Minister Govan and Bo Peep were getting to, you have to follow everything up by the promise of God. You have to follow up everything by the faithfulness of God. And so I may have confessed I was scared, but I didn't leave it there. I had to move forward in faith and possessing, quote unquote, the pure religion that meant I was going to do what God told me to do. And that was it. Whether or not I felt comfortable about it was irrelevant. God had called me to preach at that church at that time and be faithful. And that's exactly what I was going to do, because no matter what my words said, even how scared my heart was, I still had to adhere to what God was calling me to do. And that's what we have to be very, very cautious, especially in this time now of... And I'm going to put both of ourselves out there because we have conversations. We talk about the church all the time. We don't talk about you all and your lives. Let me make that very clear. We keep things in confidence, but we talk about how we move the church forward. And so as we are in this time of social distancing and scattered, and how do we move even when we merge back together, we need to know what it means to be the church and caring for others. We need to know what we need to bring forward in our walk that is relevant and is gonna be impactful for our community and our church, and what we gotta let go in the past that was just something that was good for our congregation, but it didn't help anybody, it didn't serve anybody, it didn't really do anything but just feel good in the moment. And those feel good ways of doing church, or the empty words or the bad confessions and all the other stuff that we may have just laughed off or whatnot, we don't have the luxury of that being a part of our faith life any longer. This COVID-19 has brought into light that there are things that we have to move forward in and we have to be very serious about. And as the word said, that we have to care for each other in order for us to be the church of Jesus Christ today and for tomorrow. We have to take care of the widows, take care of the orphans. And that's just the general means of the vulnerable people in our community. And let me just say it this way too, just because you are in a really nice house and you have 2.5 cars and your kids look good and clean does not mean that you're not in a vulnerable place as well. There are a lot of vulnerabilities and stuff that we are dealing with, and you have basic needs being met. And so we are trying to understand and move forward to be the church to care for each other, as the word is telling us, faith in action, not to be an empty religion, but to be that pure religion, caring for others, especially for those who look like they've got everything going on, but really might be hurting on the inside. So any comments to that?
Yes, that God has not given us a spirit of fear.
That's right.
But a power, love, and a sound mind. Faith without works is dead. Life and death lies in the power of the tongue. You can Amen. Have what you say.
Amen.
Reverend Allen.
That's right.
So when we pray about it, when we pray, we have to claim that the Lord is going to keep this off of us. I mean, you know, you got to believe what the word says. You know what I'm saying? And if the Lord said that we can be healed, we can be healed. And when we pray about this virus, we got to pray and believe that the Lord is keeping it away from us, and away from our family, and away from our friends, and away from our church family. So we got to pray and believe it, not just for us, but for everybody else around us.
That's right.
Speaking into existence, don't just, when you like basically what she's saying, like praise your way through it. Say, hey, I'm already healed, or God has covered me, or my future is bright. Speak those things into existence, because that plays right. faith, that shows that you truly believe. And sometimes you have to hear those words for you to actually believe. You have to hear yourself say them out loud for them to become real and a part of your life.
But also God said, walk by faith and not by sight. If God's for you, who can be against you? So if you believe and you have that faith, you don't have nothing to worry about. Just put him first and keep moving on, and don't worry about what's going on around you. Know God is still in control.
And that's the whole point, Bo Peep. That's the whole point, Johnny. Yes, have faith. Walk in faith that you are fine. Somehow the bills are going to get paid. Somehow the relationships are going to be reconciled. Somehow, some way, the temperament's going to be down. But do your part, too. Don't go where the people are. Wear your mask. Wash your hands. And use common sense. You know, if and I know my people love me, but if I decided to say, no, we're going to have church on Sunday, one of y'all better call me and be like, you are crazy, Reverend Allen. We are not. We are walking in faith, but not in whatever you're talking about. No. We have to really make sure that we understand God is telling us to do something. God is not calling us to be in a place necessarily to put us in harm's way. No. God's not going to call us to be crucified on the cross. Jesus has already done that. So we don't have to sacrifice. We might have to suffer to learn. We don't have to sacrifice to know. It's a big difference for that. Big difference.
Reverend Allen.
Yes, Cousin Mason.
Yeah. People listen when they know that you care. They'll listen to you. Because like you say, if you tell me church is open up Sunday, you will be sitting there by yourself.
That's right. I better be. I better be. Exactly.
Reverend Allen, this is Ed.
Yes, Mr. Ed.
My dad used to tell me, God gave you a brain, use it, boy.
And that's
right. I truly remember that you got to use your common sense.
Hey, Pastor Allen, I heard something the other day. It says no more movies, no more sports, no more restaurants, no more going out. But this is God. Give me some time.
We're definitely shut down for a reason. And I'm always one to say you never know what the reasons are. But if you miss out on this time to grow closer to God and grow closer to the people that are around you, then you've missed out. Because this was some good time to get closer to God and really hear what God is saying to and for your life. And God is always speaking. I mean, that's the other thing. Sometimes we get the notion that God is talking to me when I'm in trying to go to church. God is talking all the time. Yes, Pearl.
I wanted to say, and also our job as Christian is to stay positive and speak the word and speak positive things, because the people around us, like I still have to go into work some days. So the people around us, they need to hear some positive stuff, some positive stuff. And this right here might be a time when the unchurched or the unbeliever, this right here might be the time that the Lord will reveal himself and they'll accept him.
I believe
absolutely.
That.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. And oh. And Sherman has something to say, Reverend Allen.
Go ahead, Mr. Sherman.
Also, too, we as Christians, what are we doing with this time? Are you bringing others closer to Christ? Are people looking at your life? What are you doing to bring Christ to them? And we all as Christians, we need to be doing something. Being a blessing to others.
Amen.
People see you every day. They see me every day. And what am I doing, you know, about Christ and helping others?
Amen. Because
if you don't help one another, who do we have?
Exactly. And in this day and age when people say a whole lot, which is one of the reasons why, you know, the sermon last week went as it is with the fact check. People say a whole lot. I mean, you just don't know if people.
Reverend Allen.
Oh, yes. Yes, ma'am.
We have to practice what we preach, too.
That's right, Miss Betty.
Reverend Allen.
Betty.
Reverend Allen.
Yes, Reverend Allen. Yes, ma'am.
You remember what I said the other day? We got to walk this thing we have been talking.
That's right. That's right. That's exactly right. Piggybacking.
Now we
got
to put it to work.
That's right. What Ms. Betty and Minister Govan said,
right.
Lots of times people will trust what you do over what you say. Because they're watching, no matter what you say, they are watching your behaviors, what you do, what you don't do, all the time. And again, if you've got kids around you, they're not saying anything, but they're watching everything you do. Everything. Yes, no matter how old the children are. Watching everything. And so again, you know, for us who, you know, are called to share the word of God and to live the word of God, and that's all of us, we are the walking Bible that people see. And so James calls us into consideration our faith in action. Exactly what Mr. Sherman said. What are you doing? What are you doing? What are you doing? What are you not doing? What are you not doing? Exactly.
Any other thoughts?
Any other thoughts? Y'all are kind of quiet tonight. I'm a bit shocked. Ms. B, you know that.
I was going to say earlier, when you brought up you about being, you know, afraid of going and preaching at Oak Grove, we all have those moments, you know, where we, you know, that fear come in, you know. But then that's when we got to ring ourselves back in and pray and know that the Lord can see us through. But we are human.
Amen.
But that's going to happen. You know what I'm saying? Hey, nobody say they ain't had a you know, being afraid at times, because we all have, you know.
Amen. Well, I was hoping it would be a teaching moment.
We all have, but then when we learn the word, we got to put the word to work.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying. I understand that, but we all have a moment where
it's a growing process. But when you learn it, you got to put it to work.
Absolutely.
Right. Yep. Every now and then. But is your God and who's gonna help you to get through it. But you know, it's gonna come because we're human. It's gonna come to us sometime or another, you know what I'm saying? But we know that the Lord is going to see us through.
Exactly. That's almost like last week when we talked about being under pressure. We said that, or James was saying in that first chapter that we talked about, it's not if a storm is coming, but when a storm is coming. And so your faith is not growing because a test happened. Your faith is growing because God got you through that.
I totally believe that. It's just another test.
That's right.
Another test of your faith.
That's right.
True.
And that's why prayer changes things.
Amen.
Right.
Exactly.
And whenever these things come, you find the promise, what God said he would do, and you pray that promise. God, you said in your word, this or that.
And the devil leave us or forsake us.
Amen.
I believe this episode brought more people to God. I believe that the people that had put their Bibles up on the shelf and they were so dusty, it's not dusty today. I believe that there are more.
That's right.
I'll take that a step further, too. I think that there were a lot of churches that may have forgotten their mission and their mandate. A lot of churches that were insular and so on and so forth. And a lot of us have been drugged, kicking and screaming into the 21st century. And if we're talking about reaching not just you know, DJ and KJ's age, but even some that are older than them, they're all into this technology. You know, and our churches weren't always suited or focused or thinking along those lines. And now, every preacher you know has become a videographer of some kind. you know what I'm saying? We have been forced to make a shift that was necessary and should have been made anyway if we're serious about reaching people. And so yeah, I think there's a lot of Bibles in people's personal homes that I got open, and I think a lot of eyes got open in churches in terms of what we're supposed to be doing.
I agree exactly. with it.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Exactly.
Well, again, dear friends, we want to thank you so very much. This has been, I think, just another really good Bible study. And like I said, we're going to continue in the book of James. You saw, I pull it back up a little bit, the several of the themes, the topics that are in James. And we won't get a chance to get to all of these, but we're going to explore as many of them as we possibly can. We've got about 6 weeks, I think, of lessons that we've laid out. And definitely even, you know, getting down to that prayer of faith that we've already been talking about, what that looks like when praying in faith and healing. And so I think there's a richness. James is a challenge. It challenges us to live our faith in a very real way, to put our faith into action. And so thank you for being a part of this Zoom call, being online or by phone. And we look forward to seeing you again next week. I'm going to close us out with a prayer. If there's no other comments, I'm going to close us out with a prayer.
Thank you all again for a good night.
Amen. Okay, let me close this out together. Again, oh gracious God, we thank you for the indwelling of your word. We thank you for that seed of the word that you are indeed planting in our hearts and that you're allowing to germinate and to grow every day. Thank you for making yet another impact on that word in our lives tonight. And Lord, as crazy as it sounds, I'm almost even amazed that the words are coming out of my own mouth, but continue to put us in places and opportunities that stretch us and cause our faith to grow. It's not just a matter of us hearing it. It's not just a matter of Sonia and I preaching it, but we've got to put this into practice. And so, Lord, help me to practice patience. Help me to practice holding my tongue. Help me to practice all of these types of things. Give me an opportunity to live my life with authentic witness so that you get the glory, not so that somebody looks at me and say, what a great preacher, looks at Sonia and say, well, you better go, girl, but looks at you and say, looks at what God can do through these people. I wonder if God can work through me, use me, do with me. And so, Lord, allow us all to be witnesses for your glory, for change, turned around lives, and bless us. Send us forth now from this place and this time as we are in our own homes. Let your angels surround us and protect us. Keep us all safe from hurt and harm till we gather together again. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
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 Thank y'all. Thank y'all. Thank you all. And good night, everyone.
Good night. Love you.
Love y'all.
Love y'all.
Love y'all.
Love
y'all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, Tanya.
Hey. I was going to say, hey, Tanya.
Hey.
Has your mama been able to get on?
She was on last week. I don't know if she got on tonight, but she called in last week, she said.
Okay, so good. Because I know I left a message with her and everything. Okay.
Hey, Miss Bessie.
Okay.
Hey, Miss Bessie.